Hi, welcome to Virginia Time Travel, your portal of the Commonwealth, past, present, and future. Now, our show today deals with the American Civil War. This has become a very controversial topic, so controversial that some schools no longer even teach the history of the Civil War. We believe the best way to deal with controversial topics is through knowledge and civil discussion. History is complicated because people are complicated. The people who lived 150 years ago had the same passions, strengths, and weaknesses that we have today. They weren't worse and they weren't better, but they were different and they ordered their lives very differently. 150 years from now, the people of the 23rd century will be throwing rocks at those of us who live in the 21st century. This should make us both humble and hopeful. Now, our guest today is author William Connery, and he is going to talk to us today about the post-war career of Civil War General Robert E. Lee. Bill, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So, we all know that General Lee was the primary Confederate general in the Eastern Theater. Now we get to April 1865 and the surrender. So set the stage for us and then let's get into his post-war career.
Okay, from about June, July 1864, the war around Richmond and Petersburg fell into a stalemate. Actually, some people look at our Civil War, it began with the Napoleonic tactics of soldiers lining up, shooting at each other with muskets, and it ended with the tactics of World War I of digging trenches. And so for about 9 months, the Union forces and the Confederate forces were lined up about 20, 25 miles from Richmond down to Petersburg. When the spring came, beginning of April, the Union forces were able to punch through Petersburg. General Lee sent a telegram to Jefferson Davis, who happened to be in church in Richmond, that we cannot hold, I have to pull the army out, you better skedaddle. So that very night, Davis and the whole government went over on the last train to leave Richmond. They set the warehouses on fire. And since almost all the men had left Richmond, the fire burned, people figure, about one third of the city. So Lee is trying to maneuver so that he can swing around the Union Army and join up with General Johnston, who was fighting Sherman down in North Carolina. Grant figures this out, and he blocks Lee until they get to Appomattox Courthouse. Lee figures out, I'm surrounded, the game is up. He said to his men, I'd rather die 1,000 times, but I have to go and meet Grant. And Lee had no idea. He heard these rumors. U.S. Grant, unconditional surrender Grant. What would he do? But when Lee met Grant, they had some small talk. Grant said, all you have to do is lay down your arms and go to your home, promise you won't fight. And Lee said, well, what about our horses? Well, Grant said, well, we'll have to confiscate those. And Lee said, but we're not like you. Your horses are part of the government. Our men own the horses. They're gonna need them for plowing. So Grant said, okay, the officers and men, if they own the horses, they can take them. Even the officers can keep their sidearms. So from that point onwards, actually, Robert E. Lee would not allow anybody to say any ill about U.S. Grant.
I think one of the interesting things about the surrender is that there were a lot of diehards who wanted to go to the mountains and continue on guerrilla warfare, but it was actually General Lee that prohibited that, right? I mean,
yeah.
what was the story there?
It was mainly Porter Alexander, who's most famous for, he was in charge of the cannonade at Gettysburg when the Confederates tried to knock out the Union line just before Pickett's charge. He was a general by the time they got to Appomattox, and he said, "Sir, we can go to the mountains, we can go underground, go guerrilla, we can fight these people another 20 years. And Lee said, "There will not be the proper officers, there will not be the proper command. The war will be brought to areas that have not experienced the war. So it's better for us to just surrender. We've been beaten. Let's just at least give up this Army of Northern Virginia."
Okay, so now after 4 long years of war, Lee is a private citizen again. So what does he do?
Well, he's got a lot of problems. He first issues the what was called the General Order Number 9, which up until maybe 50 years ago, as President Lincoln's Gettysburg Address was memorized north of the Mason-Dixon line, Lee's final order to the Army of Northern Virginia commending them for the 4 years of hardship they did. Then he rode back to Richmond, and what he saw there when he got to the shores of the James was what looked like utter destruction. There was a pontoon bridge that the Union Army had put up. He could go, and the amazing thing was the fire had actually gone right next to the house where his wife and children were on Franklin Street. And if you go to Richmond today on Franklin Street, that house is still there. So it was pretty much devastation. In his own family, his 3 sons had all been officers in the Confederate States Army. And of course, they were out of jobs. Lee had 3 unmarried daughters still living at home with his wife. So he wasn't sure what he was going to do.
So they were really destitute, I guess you'd say. Okay, so now he's in Richmond, and the days after the war, somebody shows up at his door.
Right.
And who is
that? It's Matthew Brady, the famous photographer who Lee had known at least 10 years before the war. And Matthew Brady comes up and says, "General, I want to take your photograph. This is quite a momentous time." And at first, General Lee said, "No, sir, it's too soon after the surrender. I cannot permit this."
And how long was it before Brady showed up at his door?
It was like 3 days.
I mean, that's
it was pretty quick. But the thing was, Brady sent one of his associates in to talk to Mrs. Lee.
Now Brady had been on the Union side.
Yes.
He'd been taking pictures of the Union Army for the last...
Right, for the last 4 years.
Yeah.
And
but he did know Lee.
Oh, yeah, from before the war.
I see.
And Mrs. Lee. So Brady sends an assistant in to see Mrs. Lee, and not Mrs., because she's in a wheelchair, but she sends probably a member of the family out to speak to the general, and General Lee says, "Okay, Mr. Brady, you may have your photograph." And actually, the photographs that were taken on the porch behind the house on Franklin Street are some of the most famous portraits of Lee. And especially there's one where Lee is standing, and behind him is the cross brace of the door, and Lee's head is right where the cross braces meets, and it gives him like a almost like a Christ-like, like the man who is crucified for the Confederacy.
And then there was one with his two sons.
Well, actually, with his one son, Custis, and the other gentleman was Colonel Taylor.
Oh, I see.
Who was his assistant. I believe his other two sons were still being held captive by the Union, but they were soon, but it was his son Custis and his assistant Colonel Taylor.
Well, now having his picture taken was the least of his problems, because after the war, you know, there was a lot of talk about hanging people and imprisoning them, and you know, what were they going to do with all of these high-level Confederate officials and officers?
Right. Before Lincoln's assassination, he had actually told General Grant, "Let him up easy. We want the nation to come together again. These were our, in Lincoln's view, misguided brothers who were trying to set up this new nation, but we're one nation, and we're once again the United States." So Grant took this to heart, and actually there were these people who said, you know, especially General Lee was the main general, he should be hanged on a sour apple tree. And this got all the way to President Andrew Johnson, and Grant said, if General Lee, anything is done against him in the court, I will quit as commander of the army. And President Johnson knew this would be very unpopular. So he never pushed for Lee to come to trial, but Lee was not given amnesty either. So for the next 5 years of Lee's life, he was like in a limbo, that at any time somebody may come and arrest him. But he was pretty certain it was not going to happen.
For the lower level officers and men, they could take an oath of allegiance, is that?
Yeah, it's true. And actually, there was this one captain, Wise. He was a young man. He came, he knew General Lee, and he said, "General, these Union men are coming up to me on the streets. Every corner, they're asking me for my oath that I signed, and I'm finished. I want to go to Europe or someplace else. I'm going to leave this country so I don't have to be bothered." And General Lee said, "Don't do it. We need you to help build up Virginia." And this young man, his father had been a former governor of Virginia, had been a Confederate general. And he went to see him, said, "Father, I've signed the oath." And the father said, "How dare you? I feel like I'm going to disown you from the family." And the son said, "But General Lee said I should do it." The father said, "Well, that's different. General Lee said it's okay, then it's okay with me."
Okay.
And actually, thousands of former Confederate lower level officers, the regular enlisted men, signed an oath, and they basically could go back to their way of life without fear of being sent to a prisoner of war camp. And actually, prisoners of war in both the North and the South were released in the coming months after that.
But of course, Jefferson Davis was actually in prison.
Yeah, at Fort Monroe for at least, I think it was 1 or 2 years.
Oh. Now, you said after 5 years, General Lee received an amnesty. Now, how did that happen?
Well, it was a long time after 5 years. Actually,
oh, okay.
Lee sent in his oath, and it got lost, and it was finally rediscovered around 1970. And so in 1975, a joint resolution of Congress restored General Lee's citizenship, and President Gerald Ford, in August 1975, went up to Arlington House, which had been the home of U.S. Colonel and Mrs. Lee, and signed the document there, and gave a little speech about that it was about time that this man who had helped heal the wounds of the nation, that he was finally given back his U.S. citizenship. So it took about 110 years.
So it was more than 5 years.
Yes.
110
yes.
years, wow. Well, the wheels of government are very slow.
Yeah, grind slow, yeah, especially slow at time.
Okay, so now the general, he's no longer in the Army, obviously. He's not going to be getting an Army pension
no.
for his years of service to the United States. So what's he going to do?
Yeah, well, he says, I just want to settle in a little farm. And actually, he was in Richmond for a month or two, and every day people would come to see him. And he finally, he got in contact with a lady who owned a farm about 10 miles outside of Richmond, and then he went there. And while this was going on, beginning of August 1865, the trustees of a little college in Lexington called Washington College got together, and they said, well, I've spoken to someone who's spoken to Mary Lee, the general's daughter, and said her father wants a job. And he said, you know, our college needs a president. All in favor of General Lee being president of our college? And it was unanimous. And the head of the board, he had to borrow a suit, and he had to borrow $50 in order to go to Lexington, down to near Richmond, and give this to General Lee. And the first General Lee, he kind of thought, well, it's just a little college up there in Washington. But one of the people there was a Episcopal priest by the name of Pendleton, who had actually been Lee's, one of his artillerists. If you've ever seen the movie Gods and Generals, he's the man with the white beard, and when Stonewall Jackson says, you know, how's it going with the artillery? And he said, we have 4 new cannons, and we have named them Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Mm-hmm. And so Stonewall says, and I hope they spread the gospel liberally. So Lee, he takes about 3 weeks, he talks with different people, and he believes it's providential. And so he gets on Traveler and goes out. And in October, they want to have a big parade, a big hoop-de-doo. And Lee said, nope, I just want to take the oath of office, and that's it. I'm going to begin work. No big parades or anything.
Well, that's interesting, and because I guess the college wasn't what we think of today. I mean, it was pretty threadbare when he got there.
Oh, it was very. Actually, it was next to it's right next to VMI, and during the war, Union
Virginia Military.
Yeah, Virginia Military Institute, and during the war, Union General Hunter had gone through that part of the Shenandoah, and had burned VMI. And he was about to burn Washington College, and he was just stopped at the last moment. He said, "This is what is named for George Washington. He's the head of our states and of your states." So they just trashed the libraries in different places, but the buildings were still there. Now, one of Lee's main things that he did as president was write letters. One of the probably the most famous person from that part of Virginia, Rockbridge County, was a certain Cyrus McCormick. Yeah. McCormick's the mechanical reaper. 20 years before, he had gone to Chicago, made his fortune, and Lee wrote him a kind of a sad sack letter that the widows and the orphans are donating their pennies and nickels to help the college. And one of the other members wrote him a letter, maybe you could give us a small donation. And he gave him a check for $10,000. which was about $500,000. They could build a new chemistry and engineering building with that money.
Wow. Well, that's interesting. So he's definitely helping to get the college back on its feet. I think one of the things that's interesting, and you give a talk on General Lee, and I guess you give that to a lot of groups and history groups and so on. And one of the things that you mention is Lee and Grant meeting after Grant becomes president.
Yeah. Actually, in 1868 was the general election, and U.S. Grant ran as a Republican. Actually, all the Republican presidents from Grant through William McKinley. People forget, even William McKinley had been a young officer. He was a brevet major, and he was the last Civil War officer to be elected president. So 1868, Grant is elected president, and there's the campaign before that, and Lee is having a faculty meeting, and one of his professors, that G.D. Grant, he defeated our army, blah, blah, blah. And he said that President Lee got up in this man's face and said, "Sir, if you say one more word about General Grant, either you or I will have to leave this institution." And in May of 1869, right after Grant was inaugurated, Lee had gone up to Baltimore for some medical. From the time of the war, he was having problems with his heart. And on the way back, he stopped at the White House. And so these two men who had been bitter enemies just 4 years before now met Grant as president of the United States, Lee as president of Washington College. It wasn't written down, but it said they shook hands and they had a cordial meeting.
They seemed to have formed some kind of bond, don't
yeah.
they? That's very interesting that Grant would have, you know, seen him after the war, and especially when he was president. So that's quite interesting. Now, of course, Lee was a tremendous hero in the defeated South, and you talk about a tour he took through the Southern states.
Yeah, actually, shortly before his death, he took a tour with his daughter Agnes. Things went rather quietly until they got to Charlotte, North Carolina, and somebody found out, and they did Morse coded out four words: "General Lee is aboard." And it's recorded that from that time until he ended up in Savannah, Georgia, that all along the tracks there were ladies in buggies waving their handkerchiefs, and especially there were men with small children on their backs. And many of these children were Robert E. Lee Smith, Robert E. Lee Jones, Robert E. Lee Brown. And today, if you go into the South, everybody has a relative or themselves who are Robert Lee something. And then until very recently, Lee's birthday was a public holiday in many Southern states. Mm-hmm. And there was a young 13-year-old boy who got through the crowd and got himself right up to next to the general and stood there for hours looking at him, and that young boy was the future president, Woodrow Wilson.
Oh.
So there's a link between going from Robert E. Lee to World War I and Woodrow Wilson.
Now, what were the circumstances of General Lee's death? He didn't live too much after the war.
No, if you see the photographs of him, he looks like he's at least in his 70s or 80s. His hair's all white, his beard is white. He was only 63, but he had heart problems. He couldn't walk more than a couple hundred feet without having to stop, have a rest. He attended a meeting at his Episcopal church. It was recorded, the last thing he did was to donate $50 to Pastor Pendleton, who was the priest there. Went back to his home. He always said grace, and he couldn't speak. And for just a week or so after that, he passed away.
Well, we want to thank you for sharing these insights into General Lee's post-war career. And as a little thank you gift, our book, Echoes of Manassas.
Thank you.
This has been Virginia Time Travel, your portal to the Commonwealth's past, present, and future. This show has been brought to you by a generous gift from the Margarita W. and Donald J. Metzger Endowment. We'd love to hear from you at timetravel21@yahoo.com and visit our website at www.timetravel21.com. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.